talking with the celebrated Shirley Verrett, and this is how it went.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. About 2 years ago, Ms. Verrett and I attended a Callas seminar in Washington, D.C., a full-day affair at the Smithsonian, and Ms. Verrett had to leave for the afternoon session. So when the morning session ended and we regrouped again for the afternoon, my colleague, Will Crutchfield, looked us over, the remaining panelists, and said, "We don't look so good anymore." I would like you to recall your one and only joint appearance with George London, which was not a very intimate affair.
No, it was not an intimate affair. I think, but you'll have to correct me on this, I'm always getting dates mixed up. I think it was the 1962, the opening of the then Philharmonic Hall, the dedication of the Philharmonic Hall.
Maybe a couple years later.
And maybe it was a couple of years, but I thought it was around 1962. It may have been earlier or later. Am I correct? Okay, thank you very much. And we sang, was it Serenade to Music by Vaughan Williams. And I had heard of him before. I had heard recordings and so forth. But we were on stage for the one and only time, actually, on that occasion.
And, well, as I said, it was not a very intimate. There were 16 voices.
That's right.
So there were Ms. Verrett, George London, and 14 others.
Yes.
Singing.
Quite a lineup.
A terrific lineup. John Vickers.
Yes.
Many others.
Many others.
After that, you did not sing together, but you naturally followed his career. And when that career unfortunately ended and he ended up in Washington, D.C., then you had some other contact with him, which
this is right.
Tell us about.
From time to time, we would see each other at dinner parties. One, I remember it, at the home of Julius Rudell at one point with Nora and so on. And then it was in Washington that he contacted me once. He wanted me to hear a young singer and ask if I would hear her, and I said I would, and to give my opinion, and I gave a very, very good opinion because she was a mezzo, beautiful, beautiful voice. Finally went to the Met, but at this point I'm stumped because I remembered her name earlier on today and didn't write it down when I should have. But a very, very beautiful voice, and did some wonderful work at the Met, and I don't know where she is at this particular moment. I have not kept up, but I told him, very good. Go with this one.
If you will read Ms. Verrett's bio here, which is amazing, one thing that astounded me on reading it, the number of conductors you worked with. It's an astonishing listing, and I hope that at least half of them were pleasant and memorable associations.
They really were, all of them.
Because all of them.
The ones, I don't know what you have here in the bio, I didn't read it, but all of the, just about every conductor I ever worked with in my life, I would work with again. And I did work with on some of them on many occasions. Mm-hmm. And no, really great. They were great names, really great names,
Fantastic list. Great conductors,
great musicians, and I learned an awful lot from each one of them.
Yes. The other thing that you can learn from this very interesting bio, the number of opera houses around the world that Mr. Verrett sang in. And just before we came in to the hall here, I asked her the relationship between her American appearances and her worldwide appearances, not just Europe. And she said that she sang actually more often elsewhere, which is kind of surprising for us because we are so metropolitan opera oriented. Naturally, she sang with Chicago Lyric and
San Francisco.
But then Paris, Vienna, Milan, London,
the Royal Opera House. People always said that I was a European singer. And actually, from my standpoint, I always called myself an American singer because I was educated in America. at the Juilliard School of Music. The old Juilliard School of Music was my school. And so by my background, my foundation was done here in this country. Of course, when the career began, I began to coach with people from... But the interesting thing at Juilliard, if I may just go off a little bit, is that because of the Second World War, we were privileged to have many of the great teachers who had had to leave Germany or leave Europe for whatever reason, sometimes for religious reasons and so forth, or just because they didn't like what was going on over there. And we at the Juilliard in those years, I was there at 1955, we received the benefit. We got the benefit of that. And so in a sense, I was educated here in the United States, but it was with a European flavor, the background of all of the people who had come over from Europe. People call me a European singer. It's because I sang there a lot, yes.
And you sang most of your best-known roles, and we're going into it a little more detail, perhaps in a few minutes. But as long as you brought up education, your own education, I might add that you are involved at the other end, so to speak.
Yes, I am.
Professor of...
Professor of voice at the University of Michigan since September 1996, and I must say that I'm very, very happy to be there. I never thought that I had. I had always said I would not teach because I didn't want to be confined, but one of my wonderful colleagues, George Shirley, took about a year to talk me into this, and I decided at that moment that it was time to give back everything that I had learned to the younger generation. And I must say, I really work very, very hard because I'm always there. I always knew that if I would teach, I would always be what I call a hands-on teacher. I would not be one of the teachers who saw you at dress rehearsal and that's it. I am there for the students all the time. So of course it works me very, very hard. I can't do it any other way. I want to be there. I want to give them every ounce of the experiences that I have had. I even guide them in a health line because of what I went through in my career, not to be taken in by just piling pills into the body and so forth and taking antibiotics when you don't need it and so on. But I'm very happy to be there. Should I add this last thing about... I'm very honored this year because I wasn't expecting this honor to come so quickly after arriving at the University of Michigan, but I was named Distinguished University Professor this year. Thank you very much. It makes me very much more happy about it because some of my friends before I left to go to the university had said to me, this is one of the perks you will ask for, this, and this. And so I had asked for quite a number of things, and I decided I was not going to ask for a distinguished professorship. I wanted them to see me, to see what I could do, whether I could teach or not, and so on, and it came from them, and I must say this honor is so much more sweet because I didn't ask for it. They recognized and they gave it to me. Yes.
Obviously, you enjoy teaching.
I do.
And what I'd
more
like
than
to know
I
is,
thought.
Do you find it's, obviously it's a fulfilling involvement and occupation, do you feel that in your dealings with your students you get the right response? You're getting there. In other words, you can reach them.
I can. What makes it so wonderful being at a school like the University of Michigan and schools, you know, that we call five-star schools and so on, is that we know that even when students, which I did have when I first arrived, students that I didn't think should have been let into the school on a vocal basis. But having said that, because they are so intelligent, because the IQ, because the grade point average was so high, then you knew at least that when you were trying to explain something to the students, they would get it. And they do get it. And I keep notes and so forth and so on. They do get it. And I reiterate and I reiterate and I reiterate. And they have to have tape recorders and they have to write it. If they forget the tape recorder, they have to write it in longhand or in shorthand, whatever, so that they can review what I have said. And it does work. Mm. I'm very, very happy about that.
In addition to the obvious elements of teaching, do you also use a psychological dimension? In other words, prepare them for a possible, well, first of all, the pitfalls of a career and the disappointments that may or may not come, and things like stage deportment, very other things that are complementary to the voice itself, but very important to a singer.
Very good question. Yes, I do. And as I said, I had never wanted to teach. I always felt that I wouldn't. But I remember being at Juilliard, and I don't think I once saw one of the teachers when we were in the opera department come up to see what the students were doing. And I said, long ago, I said, if I should ever teach, I will never do that to my student. I will be there because I would be in a lesson with one of my friends sometimes sitting in on a lesson. And then I'd go upstairs to the opera department, you know, where we would be doing scenes and so forth. And I would say to myself, did I just hear this voice down in the studio? What happened? Because what happened when you're standing in the crook of the piano and getting all of these instructions about how to do E, A, I, and U, and whatever, and how to put consonants and so on, you go up to a place where now you have to fall down, you have to sit down, you have to lean on your hand and sing, you may have to sing in all kinds of positions, you may have to run, and so forth, and they would fall completely apart. And I always felt, and I felt that if I should ever teach, I would never do that. The minute my students had to go to a rehearsal for a scene, or scenes, whether it was for the opera for the season or whatever at the school, I would be there at that first rehearsal. And then I'm always there, really. And follow them through and, come on, let's go back to work now. Remember that when you do this, now you have to take this and you have to practice it at home. You have to practice running. You have to practice lying down. You have to practice kneeling. Whatever it is, whatever the physical action, you have to practice it as you practice your voice. They have to mesh so that you're not up on stage moving kind of like a, what do you call it, like a
robot.
A robot. You know, and like you can't sing and sing and move at the same time. We're not getting so much of that anymore, thank God. But I am there for them because of what I had seen when I was growing up. And I said, if I should ever teach, I would never do this. And I'm always there, actually too much, because it's very tiring. It's really very tiring, but I cannot. My husband said, well, when you're here, as long as some of these people have been here, you will change your mind about this. And I said, no, I will stop teaching first. I don't believe that I can leave my students on their own until they really know what they're doing. Yeah.
You obviously have the energy for it. Well, let us not forget that all the teaching activity that you were an active singer for many, many years. So let's go back a few more years and talk about your roles. In at least one opera, you performed two different roles, Norma and Adalgisa.
Yes.
And there was another opera where you performed two different roles in the same evening.
Yes.
This is worth telling about.
Yes. Well, that particular year, I think it was 1973, I should never forget it, was the year that I was able to do Cassandra and Didon in the same evening because my colleague, Ms. Ludwig, as everyone knows, had been ill and so on. And so I did the two roles, and that was quite a night for me, I must tell you. It was quite a night. I look back on it, and people after that tried to get me to do it in other places. And a couple of times I almost did, and I said, no, when you've hit a home run, a grand slam once, don't mess it up by trying to do it too many other times. But that was one wonderful highlight, and I was very pleased and happy that it was at the Metropolitan Opera that this did happen, that I had this kind of a success. I was very happy about that.
A memorable tour de force indeed. I would like to add two things. First of all, that you, in addition to your many Metropolitan Opera performances, you were quite at home. You were one of the local favorites at La Scala Milan, where I saw you quite a number of years ago as Eboli. And one final note before we leave the stage here to these wonderful singers, That I'd like our friends here to know that your biography or autobiography is in progress,
the works.
Right?
Oh, yes.
Is it
yes.
a biography or autobiography?
Well, you know, I don't quite know how to say this. I talked a lot, and then he rewrote.
All right.
And I was on videotape and all of that, and but he's actually the one, Christopher Brooks is actually the one who's doing the writing, but it's in my words and so forth. And it's past the first draft, and now we have a whole lot of going back in and filling in, because we did the broad picture. Now we're going back and filling in and then changing a lot. Mm-hmm. And I hope by next year it will be ready to come out.
Good.
Yes.
Year 2000.
Year 2000.
Right.
Yes.
Thank you very much. It's been
wonderful. Thank you so much. It's been so wonderful to see you. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Two ladies who have made the role of Lucia their own. One in this production that you're seeing tonight, and one not yet in this production, which is something I hope to correct soon. I'm talking, of course, to Ashley Putnam and Patricia Brooks. So since you're the one, Ashley, who hasn't done this production yet, I want to ask you a couple of questions, and then later, Patty and I can tell you all about how this opera is going to turn out here. How many productions of Lucia have you done?
I think it's five. It's four or five, anyway.
Four or five different ones?
Yes. But not many performances of each. The most performances I did in one production was, I believe, 10. The rest of them were maybe four performances here and five there.
What's the hardest part of Lucia?
Who are you asking?
I want to see if your part matched mine or Patty's.
I know when the hardest part is, when the reviews come out. No.
No.
Actually, I find the first act the hardest.
I agree.
There's a lot all kind of rolled into one, and you don't get to leave the stage, and you immediately have to sing a very demanding aria, in which, aside from the technical demands, you have to show the one moment when Lucia is happy and young and girlish. I think that's the one time when we get to see her happy, and yet you really have to be concentrating to get yourself in gear vocally, because it just starts right away. And then, of course, the tenor comes out right away, and you don't really have any time to rest before that duet, and I think that's one of the most difficult duets, at least that I've ever encountered.
Yes, we were sitting and listening in the wings of this performance, and when the big duet came, we all three agreed that was a killer of a moment.
Absolutely.
How old do you think Lucia is?
Oh, I suppose about 16. I mean, I suppose if we looked at the Scott, we could find out for sure.
They're sort of like Romeo and Juliet.
Yes, absolutely.
Well, Patty, you and I didn't play when I, at least my first Lucia, I wasn't quite as young as Ashley, I think. In fact, I was a lot older than Ashley when I did my first Lucia. How many productions of Lucia have you done?
Oh, Lord. I'd say about six. You know, around the country and in different places, but quite a few here.
My point in asking that is, by the time you got around to doing so many, did you finally have a Lucia that you traveled with?
In a sense. I mean, did you find, for instance, that you have certain physical idiosyncrasies that just belong to your body, let's say in the mass scene or something, that somehow always worked their way into whatever staging you're dealing with?
Of course, there were certain things that I was happy with. It depends on the director and how willing he is to allow your ideas to flourish, to happen at the moment. But, yes.
Well, that brings me to a very interesting question, because this opera, this production that we're seeing tonight, I got to do it first, and then Patty moved in. Now, obviously, I have always been a much bigger girl than Patty. We certainly don't even resemble one another. The costumes were made for somebody as tall as you and I are, and not for somebody as dainty and dainty. Patty is a very dainty and petite lady.
I know, but just meeting her tonight, I always thought you were much taller. I was so surprised when you stood up.
She had to fit into tall costumes. But what did you do when you move? What do you do, not only here, but when you move into somebody else's production? And you have a concept of your own that doesn't exactly match this one. What do you do?
Well, I think you must take the things that work for you, the things that you feel instinctively about the part, and adapt what you have. You know, I was very lucky, Beverly, because I could sit and in the city opera tradition, sit in the wings, run out, you know, count the steps for the mad scene, try the furniture out, but I could watch you and learn from you watching the first time around. And then, you know, maybe that there were a few things that I felt I wanted to do a slightly different way, and some of the things I got to do, some of them Tito was not so happy about. I had to throw them out. Some I snuck in anyway. But
as you're all wont to do.
Yes. And I don't know. Your instinctive feelings about a part happen in spite of the costume, in spite of who it's built on. But that wonderful old, that word, that New York word, chutzpah, it sort of worked very well for me, having to do second performances very often, second productions, second time around. So that, therefore, it kind of helped me not having as much rehearsal as I might have had the first time, you know, having a part built on me. So it was a simple adjustment, really, I think.
Did you ever read the novel?
I didn't. I read a few portions of it here and there, descriptions of Lucy crouching in the fireplace and like that, but I never got through the whole thing. It's pretty heavy going.
Yeah, well, so Walter Scott had I think the thing that fascinated Donizetti about this was that he actually had Lucy, as a manic depressive. And you know that Mr. Donizetti was a manic depressive. In fact, he died in an insane asylum.
I didn't know that.
And I always felt that the clue to my feeling so strongly about the fact that she was a manic depressive is that first aria you were talking about,
right?
Because she comes out and talks about spectral hands beckoning her,
like
and
a ghost
and the
story.
Blood, you know, and then all of a sudden she whirls around and says, "He's the light of my days and night," and makes every, and suddenly she sings this wonderful "Quando rapito in estasi," and she is a happy young thing, but the mood is just like that.
Split, I mean, second change.
She's such a split personality that I always felt that the thing to do was to set up her kookiness right from the beginning, that she was just mad as a hatter right from the start.
Yeah.
And in the book,
or
indeed,
at least
she
prone
is.
To it.
A little prone to it. In the book, she is nuts, and the family want her to get married because they quickly because they don't want anybody to realize how crazy she really is. And Alicia, our nice little nursery maid here, is a blind beekeeper who's a witch. So that's why Tito, I think, had all these witches brought in. Tito was also very much influenced by the Sir Walter Scott novel, and why he tried to create, especially where in the scene that we've just seen, that kind of murky Scottish mist all over the place and the witches going in and out under the bridge and all.
Yeah.
It helped me a lot because I was so fascinated with the novel. I couldn't wait. I was very upset that the brother, who's the villain in our piece, is only 12 years old in the book. That upset me a lot. It's the mother who's the villain.
Tell me, though, as Lucia in this production, how does it affect you to have Elisa so strange and unsympathetic? Every production I've ever done, she's been either a companion of roughly the same age or of the age that's portrayed tonight, but definitely on Lucia's side. And when I first saw this production, it gave me chills and, in a way, a lot of new ideas about how Lucia could go mad, because even Elisa was not a big help.
Well, and so is Edgardo. My gosh, she's a strange guy. He comes around and starts he's a bit nuts himself. Heathcliff, exactly.
Yes. You know, speaking of Edgardo, I've never had this happen to me before. I was singing in this house, in this production, with José Carreras. And this was the first time I'd sung with him. He came out on the stage, opened his mouth, started to sing, and my God, there was this beautiful young man with this incredible voice. Do you know, I went up and there was...
completely lost it.
I was lost. I didn't know what opera
didn't
this
want to
was.
Sing, just wanted to look.
I just wanted to watch him. It literally, and the conductor kind of looked to... you know,
I
it lasted a second. I got back in it, but I've never had that happen before.
Oh, I have all the time. I want to talk very briefly about the flute cadenza Lucia in the mad scene, because that is the one place where really all of us really did go off in our own direction. How did you arrive at your flute cadenza?
Well, I think we all take a look at the traditional, at least traditional versions. There's a lot of recognizable themes that we've all heard in various Lucias, and I looked at and listened to all of them. I ultimately arrived at something that felt relatively comfortable vocally for that hour of the evening, and something that worked for me dramatically. When I do Lucia, if at all possible, I like to try to not introduce anything new dramatically in the cadenza. I like to elaborate on whatever it is that we have established, the director and I, beforehand in the body of the mad scene, because I think there's plenty of material, at least for me, to go on there. So I like to either elaborate on that or have maybe some moments of lucidity. But I try to find musical themes that help me with that.
How about you?
Well, I found things that were right for me, things that I was good at. Trills, whatever it seemed to be right for the moment. I also went, do you remember Randy Michelson?
Yes.
Randy helped me find a few goodies, and I stole a couple of notes from Madame Callas and a little bit from this and that,
sure,
and put them all together. And in the same way, what worked dramatically, very important. And traditional stuff, and it changed every time.
I guess what we've said is that all of us are just a little bit of a combination of everybody else.
Really?
Well, I wish we could talk some more, but we can't. It's time to go on.
Well,
and thank you very much,
you.
Both
Have
of you, for being
watching.
With me. We'll return with the second act.
Together for a recital at Avery Fisher Hall, Sunday afternoon at 3. Hello, folks.
Hello.
Welcome back.
Hello.
Thank you.
Garrick, I've seen you fairly recently, but
that's right.
Jesse, it's been ages.
Yes, it has been a long
time. What have you been up to?
Oh, well, I've been running around the world singing, I suppose,
mm-hmm,
including last autumn, the trip to Australia again, so that's pretty far away. So I've been sort of
Where
busy.
Is your home ground?
My home ground is London. That's where I've been living for the last 6 years.
Uh-huh. Yeah, you're beginning to pick up a little English accent.
Think
there.
So?
Yes. Yeah,
oh,
a bit of a
gosh. Not another one.
Garrick, you also find yourself trotting around the world a great deal of the time.
Yeah, it's been pretty crazy this winter, especially the last couple of days. I was stranded for 48 hours in the Midwest this week, so we actually it's a miracle that both of us got in. Into New
Where
York.
Where were you?
Well, actually in Champaign-Urbana, and couldn't get to Chicago, and couldn't get to New York, and Jesse almost couldn't get to New York from Paris.
It was unbelievable. We were too near to be sent back to Paris on, mm-hmm, when was it, on Tuesday. But then when they announced that it was snowing like mad in New York, the whole plane sort of groaned because we left, I think, 79-degree weather in Paris or something. Mm. And everybody was rather surprised. And when they threatened to send us to Washington or to Philadelphia, there was an outcry of enormous proportions.
But you were lucky that those airports were closed as well.
Yes, exactly.
Traveling is so glamorous.
Isn't it wonderful?
Yes.
It's so lovely.
Well, now listen, you two, as just indicated, spend a good part of your lives running around the world. What made you stop long enough to work together? How did this friendship develop, and how did they collaborate?
Well, it's a good thing we do run around, or else we'd never be able to find each other for rehearsals.
Exactly.
We've rehearsed in London and San Francisco and every place you can imagine.
Yes, exactly.
Well, actually, many moons ago, in 75, I looked it up last night out of curiosity, Jesse and I were both scheduled to be soloists on the same concert at the Mostly Mozart Festival. And so I called Bill Lockwood, who runs the series, and I said, actually, I've never heard Jesse sing yet, but everybody has been raving to me about her. Why don't you ask her if she does that Mozart aria that has the piano obbligato and we can do it together?
Hmm.
And he said, fine, I'll ask her. And she said yes, and there was no trouble.
No trouble. It was fantastic.
It was wonderful.
Enjoyed it enormously.
Just
and then we started doing it all over the place.
That's right.
It's got to be our sort of piece.
Right. That's our party piece. And then
exactly.
We did some sort of a more involved concert in the summer, a couple of summers later.
Mm-hmm.
And
some
then
and so on.
Then this and that happened. And so once in a while we manage. It's
very good. So this is not your first recital together.
No, we did Princeton last November, also in a snowstorm.
December, actually, yeah.
December was it?
Terrible, terrible snowstorm.
Unbelievable.
So maybe we should only be scheduled in the summer.
Yes, we'll schedule our performance.
Jesse Norman, let me ask you a
yes.
question which I don't know how to ask without having it come out the wrong way.
Yes.
But I'll try.
Okay.
You have worked with a number of distinguished pianists
yes.
who are accompanists.
Yes.
And I use the word in the best possible sense.
Course.
Dalton Baldwin, who
Absolutely.
Played the spiritual.
Of course.
Magnificent artist.
Yes.
These, in a sense, are specialists in accompanying
songs,
working with singers.
Yes, precisely.
What is the difference in working with that type of a specialist and working with someone like Garrick, who is a world-renowned pianist, but does not normally take that role?
Yes, well, that's very difficult to speak about concisely, I think. But my first idea is that a person who works primarily as an accompanist probably has the idea in his own mind that he ought to be perhaps a little bit more reticent in his own performance, whereas a concert pianist is very used to having the stage to himself, mm-hmm. and very often, and I have worked very luckily with two or three people that are concert pianists, they very often are very much more willing to give more pianistically mm-hmm. in a performance, which for me is very good.
Garrick, so how does it feel to be drowning out the singer all the time?
Wonderful. I don't think it's possible, but that does remind me. My first experiences in accompanying date back to when I was about 9 years old, and at the local conservatory, they trotted out two violinists who had a very funny little English teacher who was always yelling at me that I was far too loud. And I remember about 2 years later, I went to hear a recital of Björling. And there on the stage at Carnegie Hall was this gigantic concert grand open all the way, and Björling strode out, and I thought, oh, I'd love to play for him, and nothing I could possibly do would drown him out. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, I went on to hear even louder singers occasionally. I thought, oh, my goodness. Well, that excited me when I was 11. No, in fact, it's wonderful to work with somebody who has a voice of operatic stature, a really dramatic soprano voice. Because one can support and give, and it becomes a free collaboration. It becomes like chamber music again, in the sense of playing with very, mm-hmm. very strong personalities. It's it's not a situation where I sort of have to be subservient.
Not at all, and it doesn't mean just because one is making perhaps a bit a fuller sound that one is losing at all the nuance of the mm-hmm. performance. Mm-hmm.
And besides, I like to play very softly, and Jesse likes to sing very softly too. It's something. It's one of the things that we both happen mm-hmm. to like to do very much.
Well, Garrick, obviously the volume is a controllable element, no matter what.
Of course.
But seriously, do you have to sort of readjust your pianistic thinking in this sort of a collaborative system?
Not very much, in fact. The kind of musical intelligence that I would have to apply, say, to the left hand of a flowing Chopin nocturne is not very dissimilar to the same intelligence that you apply to an accompaniment of a Schubert song.
Mm-hmm. Precisely.
Luckily, I don't have to worry about the melody, which pianos do badly anyway. So, no, it's a very luscious and supportive mm-hmm. kind of experience. I find the major difference, whether it's vocal or instrumental, is the range of the instrument I'm working with. A cello is very different from a violin, and a baritone is very different from a soprano.
Precisely.
And that has to be taken into consideration. Because it's mostly with balance questions, it's a question of range and precision also. If things are if things are precise, then balance tends to work itself out.
So it has to do with the composer as well, don't you think?
Yes, absolutely. Mm.
It's very difficult, I think, to cover almost any soprano's voice in a Strauss song, just because of the way that it's written, just because of the way the song is constructed, mm-hmm. and of course the great love that Strauss apparently had for this kind of voice.
Yes, and yet in the case of a Strauss song, you have incredibly lush orchestral sounding accompaniments.
Yes, yeah, so it's wonderful inner voices.
It's
and
absolutely,
kind of
it's absolutely like playing Rachmaninoff or something. And also, one thing I'd like to add, which is that when I do collaborate with people, I pat myself on the back. I choose them pretty well. And I find that when I'm working with a great artist who really thrills me as the listener, then to be able to work with them in a musical capacity often draws out elements in me, which I wouldn't say aren't there, that's impossible, but it draws out certain elements of supportiveness, of giving, of flexibility, or of exactness, or whatever is needed in the situation that perhaps you don't emphasize as strongly. And I think that's the greatest pleasure with working with different artists.
Hear, hear.
Yeah. Yes. Unanimity.
Fantastic.
You mentioned Strauss. I gather Strauss is on your program Sunday.
Yes, Strauss is the second group on the program on Sunday. And we're doing some lovely ones, I think. We're doing Alle Seelen, Lob des Leidens, and What is the third song?
Eine Reihe.
Eine Reihe. No.
Wir beide
wollen springen. This is a wonderful little song. It was only published in 1956 by Franz Strauss, the son. And, oh, it's the grandson. And it was really something that was sent to me in the mail, and I said, what in the world is this? Mm-hmm. And I sort of sat down in my enormous pianistic skill and sang the song, and I thought, well, this is wonderful. We'll put this on the program because it's really quite wonderful. I'm sorry I don't have a recording of it to play because it's a lovely song.
All right, well, that's group two. What's group
that's
one?
That's group two.
Well, there's even more in group two, but we won't tell you.
All right.
Yet more Strauss.
Yet more Strauss, exactly. Group one is Schubert,
uh-huh.
And we begin the concert with Die Allmacht.
Sounds good?
Yes.
Very good Easter Sunday piece.
I think so, yes.
And then after intermission?
After intermission, we have the Brahms Zigeunerlieder and four melodies of Gounod.
Very good.
Yes.
And Gounod.
Speaking of Gounod,
isn't that a nice cue? Where's that record? A brand new recording. I must say I haven't even heard it yet. Just arrived. Jesse Norman working with the Ambrosian Singers and the Royal Philharmonic under Sir Alexander Gibson. It is an album of sacred pieces of all sorts. There's Schubert here, and we have Gounod, and with Green Sleeves, and American folk songs and whatnot.
Mm-hmm.
So we thought we'd begin with the Sanctus.
Yes.
All right? So this is an extract from the Mass of Charles Gounod. You see, I don't have to worry. They had a whole orchestra in the chorus, and still Jesse Norman's score is above it all.
You see, that's why I had my own mic.
That's what I was saying.
An excerpt from Jesse Norman's brand-new recording of sacred songs, and this one from the Gounod Mass, the Sanctus, with the Royal Philharmonic and Ambrosian Singers, Sir Alexander Gibson conducting. The idea of concentrating on one type of thing, would you give the equivalent of an all Chopin recital?
Well, the only all composer recital I've ever done is all Schubert, because his songs are varied enough, I think, to bear this kind of exposé, I suppose. Mm-hmm. I don't think it would work in all cases. I'm going to do all Hugo Wolf programs, but of course his songs, again, are very varied, and the various Dichter, the various authors of the poets have contributed, of course, very different ideas to his composition of songs, and I think that could work. But I think that probably, for the most part, it would seem that people prefer programs that are, from singers particularly, that are a bit more varied, unless one is really on top of it, the whole thing, you know.
Yeah, I feel the same way pretty much for programming. I tend to prefer it.
Together with Garrick Olson. There's one very other exciting event that we want to ask you about, which is your North American
stage opera debut.
Yes,
exactly.
When, where, how?
Well, this will be November, the 24th and 26th of November in Philadelphia. And we're going to do what in America we call a double bill. We'll do Dido and Aeneas of Purcell and Stravinsky's Oedipus Rex, conducted by George Cleave and produced by Toby Robertson.
Well, you said you like variety in your programs. You certainly have found it here, right?
Your custom Dido, I mean, you know.
That's fabulous.
Looking forward to that, I must say.
Very exciting. Have you done opera much in Europe?
Yes, I have, a great deal, but never on stage in the United States.
Wow, terrific.
Yeah.
Right, New York next, I trust and hope.
Oh, next year.
Yes?
Yes, next year. For the opening of the 100th anniversary season of the Met. We're doing the Trojans.
Not bad. Terrific.
Garrick, what about your other all-star collaborations? Any more in the works?
Well, I actually do have one more extraordinary one in New York in Carnegie Hall, actually in July of all unlikely times, with Annabelle Gamson, the dancer that I've done a couple of programs with, and it's going to be, once again, a wide variety of music from Chopin to Stravinsky and Scriabin and Bartok and all kinds of things.
How do you manage to keep your eyes on a keyboard when you have a dancer up there?
Well, in fact, working with Annabelle is rather a bit more like working with a musician. Music has primacy. She views it as a piano recital with dance rather than as a dance event. I mean, it is a dance event, of course, but in rehearsals, she has to accommodate to me a lot more, in fact. Because there's no sort of taking dancers' tempos at all. No.
No, why not? I thought that's what it was.
You mean play at half tempo or double tempo or something, yes?
Oh, no, I mean, you know, sort of like accompanying a singer.
Right. Sorry. Wait for the high note to be over. Right.
Well, yes, exactly.
All right, we are going to adjourn now while Jesse and Garrick have it out. And Everything will be resolved, we trust, by the time they meet again at Avery Fisher Hall. The concert date is Sunday afternoon at 3. What a marvelous way to spend your Easter Sunday afternoon. Jesse, Garrick, thank you. It's been a great joy to have
you
both.
Thanks. Lovely to be here.
From all the famous people.
You got a Pavarotti on a knuckle there?
Oh, of course, Luciano is there somewhere. You know, I didn't initial them, so I can't identify them, but all the guys got at me one way or another.
So did you actually study fencing at some point to take on this role?
Well, I personally did study fencing with an Olympic wannabe fencer. He knew his stuff. There's a certain irony in there, however, because stagecraft sword fighting is not Olympic sword fighting.
Of course.
It's got to be a little bit more showbiz. They got to hear a little more clang of swords, and you do a head cut with an épée or a foil, which are names of swords, and you don't do that. A saber, you would do a head cut. But it's flashier. So I think some of my training did pay off in that. Hopefully I never gave the other guy nicks. But tenors often are not so skilled with the sword, and that's what really happens when you try to be safe and duck and move away and don't thrust for real. That you can really get into serious trouble. Perhaps the fullest chapter under the performance or under the opera Can Be Dangerous is a subchapter called They've Killed the Dwarf.
I love Nabucco. This is Verdi's Nabucco.
Yeah, that's a Nabucco in Paris. Goes through the whole. That seemed to be a cursed production. I won't even go into it, but it's very detailed in the book. But one thing in Nabucco, I came out standing on a shield held on the four shoulders of four soldiers, and then lightning strikes Nabucco, and he becomes a religious man and forsakes all of his sins. Well, in the rehearsals, in order to find a way to stand on this big shield, we had to do rehearsals. Well, at one point, one of the soldiers tipped his shoulder, and the whole platform, as it were, yeah, the shield tipped, and I came down on it, a leg on each side, meaning that the height of the shield was between my legs. Well, if I had been an inch shorter, or if that shield had been an inch higher,
you'd be singing soprano.
I probably would be talking with a different voice, exactly. And the things that went wrong in that production, the things that went wrong should have been filmed. There is actually a video of the performance, but it's the performance, not the accident.
Right.
That was a wild time.
We're speaking with Cheryl Milnes. You actually made your Met debut in Faust back in 1965. Were American singers kind of a rare breed back then, mid-60s?
Well, in a manner of speaking, however, Bob, of course, Robert Merrill and Leonard Warren, who had died on stage in 1960, both Americans, Richard Tucker and Jan Pierce, you know, all Americans, but it still tended to be Italian-oriented.
Right.
Although I never thought about changing my name, because nobody would confuse me. If they could say it, and they discovered that Cheryl was, in fact, a guy and not a girl, I had a certain identity. I was the opera singer with a girl's name.
Right. And coming up at a season which also featured debuts by Mirella Freni and Renata Scotto and Alfredo Kraus and Pilar Lorengar. I mean, you were in tremendous company.
Oh, my heavens,
1965.
Yeah, I should say so. And you're missing one, because I debuted with, in the same opera, that night, Montserrat Caballé.
Wow.
It was her Met debut. And, well, in my mind, it was a two-edged sword. At that time, I don't know how old you are, John, but, you know, at one point, New York had 7 daily papers.
Yeah, I don't remember 40, that.
50 years ago. Okay, you're younger than I am. So, 7 dailies. You knew you were going to get 7 reviews back in those days. I knew that having Montserrat Caballé in the cast as her debut at the Met would ensure critic attendance. On the other side of the coin, or the flip side, I could be overrun in their desire to hear the big European star, because I was the American kid, clearly. Unknown, except for some city opera things, but basically unknown. So I took a little bit of a chance, but I ended up with about 14, with some monthly and quarterly magazines, I ended up with about 14 reviews from that one performance. Unfortunately, it just doesn't happen now. You're lucky to get one. So I was lucky.
Well, now, you're a baritone. The tenor seems to be the one that gets the girl all the time. You know,
it's... On stage, yes, on stage.
Ah, okay.
Oops, oops.
You know, I didn't read that chapter in this book.
Well, you know, I determined early on it was not going to be a dishing book or a tell-all, as they like to say in the Hollywood terms. I talk about a lot of people, and I tried to be honest, and if there was some kind of overt, deserved critical comment, I said it. I didn't lie. On the other hand, though, it wasn't to dish people. Mm-hmm. You know, talk about John Vickers and Jim McCracken and John Dexter and I'm thumbing through a ton of people. It wasn't about, being cute and critical. I also tried to avoid very hard, and I think I succeeded, to write another, and then I sang.
Right.
And then I sang, and then I had a great success. And then I went on and had another great success, and then I was just so great. I can't tell you how great I was. I think... Well, in as much as it is about me, but I think I avoided that as much as possible, and I'm pleased with the result.
Well, there certainly were highs, but then in the early 80s, definitely a low with this devastating vocal cord injury that really threatened to destroy your whole career. How did you discover that this was more than just, you know, I overdid it last night?
Yeah, that's complicated. It certainly, the chapter is called A Decade of Panic, and that's not exaggerated. When a singer who has devoted their life to singing opera, concerts, art songs, whatnot, all of a sudden the instrument by which you have made a living and made your life seems not to work, it's pretty devastating stuff. It actually wasn't an injury per se, it was a vocal cord bruise. You know, we bang our skin, we bang our hand or something, we get a little bruise, it gets black and blue. Well, on the hand, on the leg, on the stomach, whatever, it doesn't mean anything. You get a little bruise, which is really just a little leakage from that tiny, tiny capillary. You get a little bruise, a little blood where it's not supposed to be. It changes the symmetry of the vocal folds. If they're not exactly equal, they don't phonate right. And... well, it's too complicated a story, except for a long time, it just wouldn't work right.
Wow.
There's a Tosca, probably some people have a broadcast from the Met, in which during Carol Neblett's Vici d'Arte, Tosca's very famous aria, mm-hmm. I'm sitting at the table having a coffee or something, kind of waiting for the Vici d'Arte to be over, and you can hear me checking my voice in falsetto to see if it would still work. Because there was about a five-year period when I would open my mouth and not be sure what was going to come out. And you can hear little meeps. And somebody called me after the performance and said, was that you making that noise? Well, I was so embarrassed because I had no idea that it would be picked up on the radio mics because it was just a soft little squeak. But I was afraid to open my mouth until I had done that little test.
So, I mean, when you title the chapter, you know, A Decade of Panic, as you say, that's not an exaggeration. Your voice did come back, but then in the mid-90s, you know, the Met eventually stopped calling, and while this isn't, as you say, a dishing book, I mean, you do write rather bluntly that you were hurt and depressed by that.
Of course. No, we won't go into any personalities, the way, you know, the European theaters seem to have a better, or the audiences maybe more than the theaters or both, have a sense of what you've done, where you've come from, your position in life, in a career, and in that house. 652 performances is a lot, many leading roles. It didn't seem an appropriate way to finish, but okay, life goes on, and 32 years is... more than your 25 traditional in the business world, and you get your watch after 25 years of service. So it was 32 years, 42 years of singing professionally. I have no regrets about career, and life goes on. Things happen. You deal with them, and you move on.
We're speaking with Cheryl Milnes, the great American baritone, whose book is called American Aria and was published as American Aria some years ago, and now, Cheryl, republished as American Aria Encore. So what's happened in the intervening years?
What's with Encore?
Yeah.
Well, we were looking for a title, the publisher's Amadeus Press, and in fact, one can go online, amadeuspress.com, or amazon.com, and order or see about all of their wonderful publications. Amadeus Press is a major
music
middle-sized player, let's say, in the publishing world. They do wonderful art books and music books. We were looking for a title that would indicate that it was still the first part of my life. The first autobiography took me to 1996, where I had just finished the Met and all of that. Well, that's what, 12 years? No, 11 years later. I've added the 11 years. And a couple of little tweaking things in the old book those things are now in the new book. So it is not the same. And we thought American Aria, same picture, Encore, kind of said it without getting too wordy.
Okay.
A couple of tweaking things. I remembered a story only the second time around. It's now in the book. Early on, singing with the Goldovsky Touring Company, I was singing Mazzetto. This is the very beginning of the career. And of course, as we know, reviews are very important, and people are often hired on the basis of good reviews, even when they're not always accurate. Good reviews are not always accurate, or bad reviews are not always accurate. Nevertheless, the printed word has power. We know that. And Mazzetto is a minor character, good character, but a minor one in Giovanni, often is overlooked in the reviews. I got a very good review for Mazzetto from a paper in Cleveland, Tennessee, maybe 5,000, maybe 10,000 people.
Cleveland, Tennessee. Okay.
Right, Tennessee. Mazzetto was great, and I used that in my publicity brochures. I just left out the word Tennessee.
So that's
you do with what you can.
That's the kind of book we're dealing with here, is it? American Aria Encore is the name of the book. Cheryl Milnes, the American baritone, and you've been teaching master classes at Yale and elsewhere. And I guess a final kind of question would be, did your own experience with your injury cause you to focus more on mechanics with the people you teach to kind of help them maybe prevent the sort of bruising that occurred to you?
Actually, no one's ever asked that question before. That's interesting, and I suppose I would have to say yes, even though I've always been an analyzer. That's very good, and I suppose health, vocal stamina, long many years of singing is a primary concern. Yes.
Even for people who didn't get their start hoisting bales of hay on the family farm. Cheryl Milnes, a real pleasure speaking with you. Congratulations on the newly reissued book, American Aria Encore. Cheryl Milnes, my guest on Soundcheck.
Thank you, John.
Is American tenor Clifton Forbes. The New York Sun said of his portrayal that he has some serious goods, strength, warmth, sensitivity, and this is my first time meeting him. Hello.
Hi.
You're sort of making me laugh, I have to say. You get up up on that stage during Die Walküre, maybe in front of one of the most difficult to please audiences, Wagner lovers, and you get up and you sing that role. No talking to me on the radio.
No costume.
I know, it's true, isn't it?
No trappings.
When you
yes.
get to be someone else, it's easier, isn't it?
It is.
Being yourself is hard.
To a degree, yeah. Yeah. There's nothing to hide behind.
and you know all your parts, you know all your music, you know all your notes, so it's almost easier. And you know, Zygmunt, I've noticed, relatively, has very little time to make his mark in the ring cycle. He has just two acts.
Yeah, and that's always sets into motion future things, obviously, and
and the Brunhilde situation, all of those are based upon this character that you see for two acts.
Mm-hmm.
So you really have to stand up quick and make your mark in terms of the importance of the character to the entire ring.
Do you have to know your character really well? Because you sing the role quite a bit.
I think you do. I think you have to know him. I also tend to think that if you view too far ahead into where his actions take him, then you lose the impulsiveness in the character that you're trying to portray.
See, now that interests me, because I was wondering if you really need to be a part. You're not in the rest of the ring, but do you feel like the rest of the ring is taking place without you when it's being performed and you're at home and it's your night off and, gee, they're doing all that stuff that I set them up for? I really should be there.
No. I really don't. I don't think about that. I mean, there are times when I like to go to performances, sure, but in terms of the continuity of the story, no, I don't think about it that way at all.
Mm-hmm. Does being on for so little of the performance of even De Valkyra make it more of a challenge or less of a challenge for you?
Well,
do you have to be more intense in what you do, more condensed?
Well, the pressure is on to establish character. In a very big way, the pressure is immediate because you have to portray to the audience the impulsiveness of his youth, the tragedy of his youth, the loss of love, the amount of tragedy that has already occurred in this brief life. All of these things come into play, and you don't have a whole lot of time to do that. So, yeah, it's important.
Well, the role you play, for people who don't know, Siegmund is in love with what turns out to be his twin sister, Sieglinde, and they run away from her husband, Hunding. And by, I know, it's awful, isn't it?
Yeah.
By the end of the second act, he's killed by Hunding.
Right.
Which is as it should be.
In the great scheme of things, yes.
In the big scheme of the ring.
Right.
And,
yeah.
And you're actually the children of Votan.
Right.
The big god.
Right. Which, I mean, Fricka comes out in the beginning of that, too, and, you know, chastises Votan for all of this and basically sets it right so that he cannot protect me anymore.
Mm-hmm. The first act is so sublime. Can you get carried away with it as much as the audience can, or do you have to be vigilant? Do you have to be ever in control?
Wow. That's kind of a... It depends upon the night. Sometimes you, as a performer, you get so involved in things that you make choices that are for yourself as opposed to the audience. I think there has to be a really strong balance between those choices. You have to, it's as if there is a room in a house that this is taking place in, and you want to take the audience to this room, open the door, show them the inside of the room, let them go in and experience, but you can't cross into that doorway or to that room. However, with this repertoire, it's impossible not to step in there with them. So I think you have to be guarded about how much you do that.
Because it's ecstatic. The music is ecstatic.
It is. It literally can just sweep you away.
What does it feel like singing it?
Oh, it's a blast. It's a wonderful experience. All the colors in the orchestra, the way Wagner paints his characters with the textures of the orchestra, it's an extremely fulfilling experience.
Are Wagner singers different sorts of animals than other singers?
Very much so. Very much so. I don't know how or to describe it. And I don't mean it. Just different is a good word.
Because there's such a line. They're almost a different animal. They're sort of a breed. It's a different sort of voice. So you wind up singing a lot with the other people who do it a lot.
Right. It's a smaller family. And you do have a lot of repeat cast members when you move from one opera house to another opera house. If you're doing Valkyrie here and then Valkyrie, say, Amsterdam, chances are it's going to be somebody you've sung with before. It is a friend of mine named Albert Dolman, who is I've done a Tristan with, and he's a fabulous singer. He calls what we do heavy metal. putting it, you know, in that terminology. And it's a different mindset. It's a different voice. It's a different physicality.
You're singing with a couple of different Sieglindes during this run. You just came from two with Adrian Piaczonka, which was very exciting. And your second?
Debbie Voigt.
Debbie Voigt is going to be singing. So you're well in rehearsal. You're ready to go on with. Have you done one yet with her?
Yeah, we did one last night.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I've sung it with Debbie before.
Mm-hmm.
So again, and with Adrian as well. So again, no
this
surprises,
is, this is
you
the
know.
Family, yeah.
Yeah, so.
So have you ever met a Wagnerian artist who was immune to Wagner's music, who could just sort of take it or leave it, but that's what they do, because that's what their voice is?
No.
Is that impossible?
I don't know that it's impossible. I'm sure somebody could. But again, it is something that I think, you know, I used to hate the word organic, but there is a reaction to music. If from each individual who sings, no matter what they're singing, there's a reaction for them organically within their being to that music, how it moves them, how they respond to it. And if you are a musician, it is going to move you. There are times you find yourself almost forgetting where you are, if that makes sense.
Are there other roles outside of Wagner that you wish you could be singing?
No. Early on, when I started this, people were saying, oh, you have to begin with Mozart. And forgive me for saying it, but I don't like Mozart.
You're not the only. There are other people here who have said the same thing, and I won't mention names.
But for me, if I was going to sing, I had to sing this stuff. Things like this, and Otello, and Fidelio's, and Samson's, things that spoke to me, or that were part of me, that moved me. And I think if an individual is in their groove, or their nature, however you want to put it, then they bring something to the table if it speaks to them in a very personal way.
Are you a romantic?
No.
Emotional?
Yes.
But not a romantic.
No, not in the grand scheme of things. No. But
you know, I read an article that played up your Tennessee roots in contrast to you being a world-class opera singer, and I imagine we should be more sophisticated than all of that. Does it ever seem like a contradiction to you?
It does. Oftentimes, if you open your mouth and you have an accent, it's almost as if people's estimation of your IQ will drop about 20 points. You know, so there is that aspect of it. But I don't think that regionality is an issue with music. It never has been for me. My father was a conductor. My mother was a music educator.
What kind of a conductor was your dad?
He was a choral conductor. He ran was dean of a music school in Missouri for about 20 years.
Did you sing for him? Were you in?
I grew up around it. But I grew up hearing the Harriman Art Series at the college where my father was teaching. Heard Pavarotti's American Recital debut, Leontine Price, Jerome Hines, Isaac Stern. All of these were contributors to my early ear in terms of quality and artistry. So I don't think regionality so much really comes into it. But then again, part of what you bring to the table as an artist is your makeup of where you are, where you were reared, if you want to use that word, yeah.
Did you know early on that you wanted to sing, or was that just too much what your parents did? They were in the arts, you're going to...
They were in the arts.
You're going to build houses or
something. Yes, I wanted to do something besides that.
What did you want to do?
I didn't know.
Did you start out doing something else?
I did. I did several things, construction, you know, things trying to find your way, but it was always drawn back to this. And...
Was there ever a point where you realized, you know, I've been listening to too much Led Zeppelin. I think I have to listen to Puccini again. Now, I miss that. Verdi, Wagner, my gosh.
I have a very eclectic taste in music.
Do you?
I do.
What do you like to listen to?
Anything and everything. You know, old recordings, Ludwig Suthaus, Wolfgang Wengassen, Melchior, and then turn around and Alan Jackson, or, you know, something along those lines. It just depends on what kind of mood I'm in. So.
Was there a point at which you discovered the tenors, the voices that came before you, or were they always sort of with you?
No, I remember as a kid, my father had a bunch of records from early Caruso records and Buehrling, and so... I remember, you know, 5 and 6 years old hearing Buehrling sing La Fleur and things along that line. So I was hearing that early as well. So.
Did you ever say to yourself, I can do that?
I used to try.
I think a lot of people would.
Yeah. But it was humorous at the time.
Tenor Clifton Forbes is my guest during this intermission of Manon Lescaut. He's singing the role of Siegmund in Die Walküre. You live in Tennessee currently, don't you?
Yes, I do.
Is it a little slice of heaven? I've never been there.
It is absolutely wonderful.
Tell me.
Except for the allergies.
What?
Oh, they're terrible.
What sorts?
Name it, and it is there.
Things that blossom on the trees?
Blossoms, molds. It sits in a geographic depression, so everything kind of runs into what is called the Cumberland Plateau and then remains stagnant. It takes a major storm to blow it out, so it takes a while.
So anyone who's listening on Sirius who lives in that area...
They'll know exactly what I'm talking about.
He knows exactly what is happening down there. Are you an outdoorsman as well, I think?
I am,
read that,
very much,
right?
So, yes.
What do you like to do?
Oh, just, I like being out there.
Sports?
Fishing, hunting, mm-hmm. things like that.
Do you do that mostly when you're at home, or can you do a little of that when you travel to staying other places?
I try not to do that when I travel. I never have. I like to focus on my job, what I am doing, and I think that's the same for anybody in any position. If you're at your job, you are working and focusing on your job.
So, I mean, you travel the world, you sing everywhere. Were you ever tempted to move to a major opera hub?
No, I wasn't. I know that this business is one of nomadic existence, I guess you could say. So it never made sense to me to be in a place unless I was going to work at that house full time. And those positions are few and far between here in the States. I chose to remain in Tennessee and do my traveling from there, that being the home base.
Now, you're singing Die Walküre at a remarkable time with Maestro Lorin Maazel conducting for the first time here since 1963. Was there anything you could sense about this being even special for him?
He was subdued, and I kind of felt like perhaps it was him, you know, just trying to enjoy the moment and relax into it. This was a big return for him, and we're all happy for him.
The audience is so excited whenever he steps into the pit.
Yeah. It's almost electric.
You must be backstage hearing that.
Yeah.
Because all he has to do is walk, and he comes out quickly. I mean, he doesn't waste any time. He comes right out there, and the audience just hits the roof right away.
Right, right.
Amazing. Well, Clifton Forbes is going to be heard as Zygmunt in Die Walküre this weekend when we bring you the Saturday matinee performance of it here on Sirius 85. You're an old hand at doing the broadcasts, aren't you?
I've done several, yes.
Yeah.
Yes. Samson, I think my debut was Acacio in Otello in 94 with Domingo as Otello. That was a, for me, that was a real treat.
I'll bet.
Yeah, and
what
James
was that
Morris.
Like? Any
was,
memories from that?
Iago. Oh, yeah. I had one or two rehearsals, and I happened to turn to a chorus, one of the chorus members behind me before the curtain went up, and I said, if I'm in the wrong place, just push me to go where? And I sang my first line, and I just stood there, and I felt this hand on the back of my costume pulling me across, because I was frozen. You know, I sang my line, and then just stood there, and they were so kind, and you know, throughout the evening, helping me get from place to place. And Placido and James were, you know, wonderful colleagues, very supportive, and to have, you know, Maestro Levine in the pit, that was a real good memory.
Well, we're going to be listening to you on Saturday. We have to thank you for coming up and talking with us, Clifton.
Oh, it's my pleasure. My pleasure.
Stay with me. This is.
Mm-hmm. I think that's the bottom line. You work on it until it becomes second nature, so you're not thinking about technique. You're just thinking about the music. And then at that point, then you can let yourself disappear.
I heard that your favorite roles are ones in which the music just grabs you in a physical way. Tell me more about that. What do you mean by that?
It has to be a visceral connection. It's got to be something that on the inside reaches out. It can't be simply a cerebral exercise. It mm-hmm. can't be a mental thing. Sure, you have the appreciation of the music and the craft and the composition, but it has to be something that reaches out and just grabs you.
Well, Wagner singers are a very small group, apparently, who keep running into each other in productions all over the world. You've talked about that. And one of your fellow Wagnerians called this music heavy metal opera, which I love.
Yes, Albert Doman.
What would you say to that?
I say he's exactly right. if you can put it in that terminology, yeah, it's heavy metal.
In pop culture.
Right,
term,
yeah.
Certainly. Quickly now, you say you're not romantic, but you're emotional. What's the difference?
I don't know. I wouldn't term it romantic in terms of thinking classic romantic thoughts. Mm-hmm. For me, it's an emotional connection.
Our wonderful Clifton Forbes here, Zygmunt in Die Walküre of Wagner. I'm Lawrence Elijah, live backstage. Thank you so much for spending some time.
My pleasure.
Wonderful,
thank you.
Wonderful singing. Now back to you, Margaret and Ira in the radio booth.
Thanks, Lauren. Yeah, I'm with Ira Siff here in the radio booth, and I had a chance to talk to Clifton Forbes and to Lisa Gastein, and both of them were telling me how Wagnerian singers really feel very much like a family.
Beautiful women with spears and shields, they are the Valkyries. Hello, ladies.
Hello.
So nice to have you here. Now, Claudia, Mary, and Jane are singing the Valkyries for what must be the millionth time. What do you tell the new girls about what it takes to be a Valkyrie?
Watch your spear, dear.
No stealing my answer. And that's exactly it. Yeah, I think the hardest thing to get used to is the fact that you have an eight foot spear in your hand, and a lot of times we're all bunched up together in a big lump, and it's very easy to sort of knock the knees out from one of your sisters because it's a big bunch of spear behind you that you have to get used to dealing with.
Mary?
Yeah, well, I do some yoga, so I tell people, get your best warrior pose going and get out there and do it.
Now, for you new girls who are singing the role, what does it take to be a Valkyrie for the first time?
For me, one of the hardest things was that most of my roles are pretty feminine. Mimi, the Countess, so on and so forth, and this is not at all... These are not girly girls.
Well, actually, I play a lot of pants roles. This is Laura Vlasic-Nolan, and I'm used to playing more of the manly man-woman, I guess you would say. Macho woman.
And for me, I think a lot of concentration, watching the set, because they are very tricky, and watching the conductors, and watching our colleagues, and responding to all of our things.
I've been typecast. This is perfect for me.
It's great fun. It's a bunch of women on stage, and what could be more fun than that?
Kelly Kay?
Yes, it's really physical. A lot of running up and down, and then turn around and take a deep breath and sing your lungs out.
Have you all mastered the bumping of spears and the swagger speaking of all that goes with being a warrior maiden?
Yes.
Jane?
Yes, we have a secret handshake, and we have mastered it.
Yeah. I'm going to ask you about that in a minute. How about you, Claudia?
Well, you know, the funny thing is that every time I've done Valkyrie over the years, the greetings between sisters change because the relationships between your sisters on stage change. So it's always an evolving thing, and it's sort of fun to get used to a new Schwestern on the rock.
So let's hear more about this secret Valkyrie initiation. What's the real story? Who can shed some light for me?
I'm for sure not in on the secret Valkyrie handshake.
Oh, you are.
Yeah, one, two, three, ready?
The secret Valkyrie handshake is actually more of a cheer. It's not so much a handshake as it is a herky.
Is it something that's appropriate for radio? Can we hear it?
Well, you can't really see it.
I mean, see.
If this were a TV broadcast, I would definitely do the Valkyrie cheer.
And as you do this together, do you feel yourselves becoming a sisterhood, for lack of a better word, a group that is uniting?
Like,
yeah,
one for all and all for one.
Yes.
Yeah. Put your hands together, girls.
And they are putting their hands together. Now, there is a great laughing motive that you sing in harmony. What are the Valkyries laughing at?
Oh, well, I think the decapitated bodies, you know, no. I don't do the laughing, but they're laughing at each other. They're laughing at the fact that they're just come back from battle, and now they're going to have a great time.
Well, we're a good-natured group, too. I mean, we're out there riding around on flying horses, just having a good time, you know, racing from battlefield to battlefield, and we're just a bunch of good-time girls.
How does it feel to sing one of the most famous scenes in all of opera? When you come out, Hoyo Toho.
I was very excited to sing this because the way I tell my parents and my family and people that don't know much about opera is I'm singing in the opera, you know, that goes dun 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 dun, 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 and then they all know what I'm talking about.
I just had that conversation with someone the other day. I said Wagner's Die Walküre, and they said, "Oh no, I don't know that." And I sang it. I said, "Oh, of course."
Yeah. Oh, that.
That was opera. From that movie, right?
Yes, yeah. Exactly.
Exactly.
Not only movie, TV commercials too.
TV commercials as well. Yes. It's everywhere. Yeah. It's ubiquitous. Now, Clifton Forbes, Zygmunt, who I spoke with just a few moments ago, he talks about Wagner singers being different from other singers. What do you think about that, Jane?
Well, I don't know. I would say stamina has got to be a part of it, but there are certainly other operas that are long, but Wagner tends to be very long.
Claudia?
Well, stamina, definitely. It's also very small, it's a small club of people who actually are out there singing Wagner. So I think it's a very close-knit society, and that stamina issue, and it is athleticism throughout all the roles.
I can't thank you so much, the eight Valkyries, for joining me. In order, Kelly K. Hogan, Claudia Witt, Vlasic Nolan, Jane Bunnell, Wendy Bryn Harmer, Leanne Sandel Pantaleo, Editha Kulchak, and Mary Phillips. Thank you so very much.
Thank you.
I'm Lauren Toulage, and live backstage at the Met. Back to you, Margaret, in the radio booth.
Thank you, Lauren. I don't think he'll ever be the same. You know, what a sterling, shining sound these Valkyries make.
This is a particularly strong group. I've worked with some of those ladies when they're the star of an opera, and this is like eight leading ladies in an ensemble. It's terrific.
Grace, good to see you.
Thank you.
Absolutely splendid. What have you been doing all summer? Resting
working,
and recuperating?
No, as a matter of fact, I did five performances of the Verdi Requiem in Buenos Aires. And then I'm in rehearsals with the City Opera for
debut. That's one of the reasons we have asked you here. After all, we like to celebrate young artists who are making debuts, and here you are about to start a new career at the New York City Opera. So tell us how this came about.
Well, I think it was actually through my manager, Doug Sheldon, and Beverly Seals. And they were sitting down chatting about projects that one could take on at City Opera. And I don't know whether it was his idea or hers, but in any case, they talked me into doing Nabucco, and I'm really delighted to do it. And it's a wonderful production. And I felt that it was a time for New York to hear Nabucco. They haven't heard Nabucco in ages. And since I put it in my repertoire since 1979, I thought that this was the time for New York to hear it with Bunbury.
So you really went because of the role. You went
yes,
because
absolutely.
You wanted to perform it here and to have it heard
yeah.
here.
Well, you see, I asked the Metropolitan if they were interested in doing it, and they were not interested. And Beverly came up with this idea, I thought, well, this is what I want to do. I mean, I was approached to doing something at City Opera. I mean, it sounded like a crazy thing, as one says. I come from the Metropolitan, go to City Opera. But for me, the important thing is the work of music that I'm doing. Mm-hmm. I wouldn't go there to sing my usual Trovatore or who knows what, you know, Salome or whatever, because I've done those things here in New York. But to do something that is different in a situation that's different, but how can you lose?
How different have you found the working methods at City Opera, the rehearsals, the way the company functions? Is it different?
It's different, yes, it's different. It's more of a family at City Opera. They don't really make too much of a differentiation among their singers, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. There's not this star atmosphere, which I do miss a bit, you know, from the Metropolitan. And, you've been accustomed to certain treatment, and it's kind of like a shock to not be treated in a certain fashion. But they're all very nice over there, I must say. They're very nice, they're very helpful, and it's, I think, a very positive working atmosphere. Mm-hmm. I like it quite a lot. I don't intend to stay there forever, but I'm enjoying certainly the Nabucco.
Terrific. We cannot represent you in Nabucco because you have neglected to record it thus far. But
well, there are a lot of pirates around, though.
Well, I know, but we're a high class station,
oh,
and
we don't
do this sort of thing. You see, so we're waiting for the real one to come.
Yeah.
Meanwhile, we thought we would represent you in a number of Verdi roles. But first, before we get there, there is one other recording that I wanted to share with our listeners. It is called Voices of My Mind, and it was written by that great operatic composer, Cyril Ornadel. So let's listen.
There's nothing that you say that's different. You hold me in the way you always do. And yet I feel a premonition. Things are not the same for me and you. Your eyes look sadly into my eyes, like mirrors that reflect another scene. You're miles away in someone else's arms, while I'm still living in our dream. And the voices of my mind are saying words that I don't want to hear. The voices of my mind are echoing that you no longer care. How can you leave behind the many things, the million dreams we took so long to find? Our love will disappear, but I still hear the voices of someone loves as much as I do. You notice every sigh that makes the day. You notice when the world has magic, and when the magic goes away. And the voices of my mind saying words that I don't want to hear. The voices of my mind are echoing that you no longer care. How can you leave behind the many things, the million things we took so long to find? Our love will disappear, but I'll still hear the voices of my mind.
Yes, that's Grace Bunbury.
A great operatic composer.
Yes, but a pretty nice song.
It's a lovely song.
And a very striking performance. What possessed you to put out what is, for all practical purposes, a pop record? The other side, I understand, is doing great in England on the charts. Natalie is climbing up.
You see, the whole thing came from the Natalie that I did in Washington for the presidential inaugural gala. And the gentleman who wrote the lyrics to Natalie heard about it from some far-off woman who knows from where. Anyway, he heard about the fact that I had sung that. And I was in London at that time. He called me up. We made an appointment for a little meeting to see whether I really wanted to record it or not. Was I interested, et cetera, et cetera. And before I left, Herb Breslin's office and Doug Sheldon's office over at CAMI, they were absolutely inundated with phone calls about this little Natalie. So we decided, well, the best thing to do is to record it. So this man really came like a godsend, like a bolt out of the blue. And so I said, well, sure, I'd like to record it. Now, the reason I record the voices of my mind is because you have to have something on the second side, don't you?
Right.
So we decided to do the voices of my mind, and I'm supposed to do a long player.
That means another 8 or 10 songs, huh?
Yeah, another 10, yeah. And this version of Natalie is not exactly the one we used in Washington. So what we're going to do on the LP is we're going to start it off with the one on this little single, and we're going to end it on the other side with the Washington version of Natalie. So it gives the American public two versions of Natalie.
And what are the other 9 songs likely
to
be?
Well, we haven't really decided, but it's going to be something on the order of let's say something like Barry Manilow, Frank Sinatra, Johnny Mathis, in that genre, you know. Uh-huh. Nothing that you can tap your feet to too quickly.
Grace Bunbury, do you enjoy listening to popular music?
I do. I mean, I have my favorites. Mm-hmm. I don't listen to just any popular music. Got to be really the biggies, you know, the biggies. Like Charles Aznavour, Dionne Warwick, Sinatra. Those are really my favorites.
Well, to go from Aznavour to Dionne Warwick, that's a pretty wide spectrum.
Not really. They're all the same category, I find. They're all chanteuses.
Yeah, I guess.
Chanteuses.
How do you approach the singing of this material? Because one of the marvelous elements of this record, I find, is that it does not sound like an opera singer attempting to do a pop song.
It's very difficult. Believe me. And I understand why opera singers don't do it like this, because it's so difficult. And you've got to completely divorce your operatic way of singing from your whole body. You don't think about opera. All of us, and you've got to have a very open throat. We singers, opera singers, you get to a certain point in your voice. I mean, for me, it's E or F, and you have to make a bridge. But in this kind of music, you don't dare make a bridge, because that's when it starts to get operatic. But beside that, the entire production is completely different. It's very open-throated singing. I call it open-throated. For somebody else, they might term it something different. But for me, I open my throat a completely different way, and I have to vocalize the same way, though. But I teach myself not to get operatic. You see, I said, no, that's the wrong one, Bamba. Yeah, go to push the other button, you know, push the pop button. But it's not an easy adjustment. I thought it would be easy, because you, as an opera singer, you have a beautiful voice, and you think, oh, it's not, let's walk around the block. Yeah, it's not. Very difficult.
Well, now, you've done spirituals. Is that the same?
No.
Because you sing spirituals closer to the style of the concert.
Yes. It's, I find this kind of music far more difficult than singing operatic music. Well, maybe it's a different kind of difficult. Mm. But for an opera singer to go into that kind of music, it's not an easy feat, I tell you.
All right, well, nonetheless, easy or otherwise, we look ahead to the LP, and perhaps if we have time at the very end of things today, I'll play Natalie as well.
Good.
So you'd like to share that. However, we want to stay with Verdi. We began, actually, before you arrived, we played the Don Fatale aria, which I understand, according to the notes of one of these albums here, you began your career with on the Godfrey show. Is that true?
Absolutely. It certainly was. That has been my war horse. Every competition I was in and won was with Don Fatale.
So that was a good luck piece.
Absolutely.
All right, and we will not take that one again. We just had it on. So we will go to the gardens of the Moorish mansion.
Fine.
It's this Eboli singing of the Veil from Don Carlo. And I understand that you caused a bit of a stir with this in London.
Yes, as a matter of fact, I did my London debut as Princess Eboli. That was in 1963, I think it was. And they had said... one doesn't take any applause, you know, like acknowledge the applause in the open scene. And I wasn't expecting any great applause, actually, after the Canzone del Velo. But the house just fell in, so I thought, what shall I do? I mean, it was my first really big outside engagement, you know, coming from Basel to London. So you just followed instructions, and as the applause was, you know, getting louder and louder and louder, I thought, what should I do? So I looked over in the corner in the wings, and I saw the stage director, and he says, "Well, wow!" It just went on and on and on, and I tell you, I never ever in my entire life thought that the Canzone del Velo would get such applause. Mm. But I understand they had never had a mezzo to sing it with that agility. Plus, I had the two verses, you see. And I think the two verses is what did it. You see, you must. The whole idea is just
much.
That's right. Is to put it all in. Don't cheat.
All right. Well, we mustn't cheat either, and announced that it was Georg Scholti conducting the orchestra in the performance. And we also will pause briefly as the New York City Opera opens its grand opera season with Nabucco. Then after the Thursday opening, there are performances Sunday, that is a week from today, on Wednesday the 23rd, Saturday the 26th, Tuesday the 29th. That gives you 2 days off in between each performance.
Yep.
You like to loaf a lot, huh?
No, that's not it. You know that.
No, I do know that. But, Grace, seriously, what does a singer do in the off days? Do you work? Do you rest the voice entirely? What does it do?
Well, on a schedule like that, there's not very much that I do. Mm-hmm. I might go to my doctor's for my vitamin injection, or I might take a walk around the block, but I don't do anything that's really very strenuous. No. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I let myself be very pampered.
Now, tell us about Nabucco. What sort of a role is it? Is it a strenuous one?
It is. It is. Especially the first and second acts, yeah. My first and second big scenes are really quite strenuous. After I've done the Cabaletta, then I'm home free. There's no problem more for me. Because, then, you know, it only goes up to, afterwards it only goes to a B flat or B's. Before I've got those high C's to do and all those florid runs. My worst part is really the beginning of the opera, which I don't mind. I'd rather have that and not have to worry about it later on, like in Macbeth, where you have to worry about the high D flat at the end of the opera. So let me have the hard part first. It's a difficult role in that she's not exactly very sympathetic human being. You know, one doesn't have much empathy for Abigail, but it's a wonderful part to play. Wonderful part, and especially in this production, there's wonderful staircase, and you can do a lot with the stairs, and a wonderful throne, you know. It's always great. It's just fabulous. I'm waiting for it. I'm looking.
You really enjoy the dramatic aspect, obviously.
I do.
Have you done a musical comedy? Have you done anything of that sort?
No.
I just had this vision of My Fair Lady when you mentioned the staircase, you know, that scene when she arrives there all resplendent. It's a stunning one. I can just imagine that sort of thing. And in terms of Verdi generally, baritones have come and groused and grumbled terribly about how difficult he writes everything, even though they love it. But
well,
do,
In this Nabucco, I think it's the most difficult thing I've ever sung of Verdi. I really think it's the most difficult of all the Verdi operas. Now, I may be wrong because I've never sung, is it Orabella? Is it from Due Foscari? I'm sure they tell me that's really very difficult. But as far as dramatic roles are concerned, Abigail, I think, is the worst. I really do think so. Lady Macbeth is a difficult lady. She's got her problems in there. But Abigail, I think, takes the cake.
Oh!
Abigail may take the cake, and I guess we'll find out about that on Thursday at the City Opera. But while we are impatiently waiting for Grace Bunbury to record that role from Verdi's Nabucco, we've heard her as Lady Macbeth. So, Grace, you really do have to pace yourself in this sort of an opera.
Sure. In every opera, actually. Even in a one-actor like Cavalleria.
Well, how does that work in a recording studio? Do you feel, therefore, if you can get away with doing one aria at a time and then come back the next day, that you can somehow give more or let out more? Or,
you mean in an entire integral opera, or you mean in a recording well, where you have just arias?
I would imagine either way, because you can do your particular arias even in a complete recording in any sequence you want. Mm-hmm. Is it therefore easier? Is it therefore better? And you are able to do more since you don't have to hold yourself back and you don't have to pace yourself in that same way.
No, I think you pace in a different way. For the operatic stage, you have also to deal with many other things, not just your voice. But in a recording, I think, for me at least, that I have to, from piece to piece, I have to pace myself. I mean, I'm going to sing the aria from Nabucco. In a recording session, and the aria, the duet from Nabucco on the same day, then of course I have to pace myself accordingly. Mm. And if they come immediately one after the other with no big break between, you have to pace yourself, definitely.
But it would seem that if you did that,
plus,
you would get
don't forget you have a microphone, whereas on operatic stage you don't.
Well, that picks up every little nuance and shading.
But you don't have to give quite so much voice. Uh-huh. You know, that's why I find it so many. I mean, there are many. Well, let me put it this way: there are some singers who record things who don't sing them on stage, and if for them it's much easier because they don't really know how much power they're going to have to give on stage.
I see.
And for instance, there's a recording of Nabucco with Renata Scotto. Now, Renata can't sing that on stage. She's already admitted that, so I'm free to say this. So she will not do it on stage, but she can certainly sing it on a recording. Why not? I personally would not do it. I don't think it's right, because I think it's unfair to the audience. It's misleading. I think that the audience should hear a singer sing what they sing and not just bits and pieces of the operatic repertoire. But anyway, she's done it, and she did it very well.
All right. Are there any operas that you would like to do now that are in your repertory and that
well,
you would
like to
record?
I'd like to do Nabucco.
Well, sure.
I'd like to do Gioconda. I'd like to do Gioconda because I think that's really one of my big pieces, mm-hmm. and a piece that I think people associate me with. I'd like to record, perhaps at a later date, a Macbeth. Mm-hmm. And by the way, I think there's the Salzburg Macbeth that we did years ago with Fischer Dieska is going to be brought out on recording. Yeah,
very
they've
nice,
gotten the rights
nice.
from the Salzburg Festival as well as from the artists. I think that should be coming out pretty soon.
That will be worth. Mm. Worth the wait, I guess.
Yeah, really.
We are going to conclude with Pace Pace from La Forza of Verdi. Mm-hmm. Now, this, I presume, presents a different sort of difficulty. It's not the scenery-chewing kind of...
No, it's rather segment. Subtle.
So how do you deal with that? How do you approach that to get the same kind of intensity level?
I don't know how to explain that, Bob. I think you have to take the text into consideration, and the atmosphere, the mood, and you gauge yourself accordingly. You sing Pace with the same dramatic intensity, but you do it in a different way. Pace starts off pianissimo, you build it to a forte and back to pianissimo, and the whole aria goes that same way. Everything is like waves, it goes in waves, and it's reasonably easy, I say, because you have two moments that are really quite difficult. You have that very exposed high B flat in Van La Pace, which has to be absolutely bang on with all that lovely roundness of sound. And then of course, you have that very big Maledizione on the end, which is just hold forever, of course, if you have enough wind. There are three moments. The first, the pace, the in van la pace, and the maledizione. Those are the three big moments in the opera, and they're all three different types. The first one is pianissimo to forte and back to pianissimo. Second one is all pianissimo, and then the end is forte. I find for me that aria has to be done with a lot of introspection and a lot of subtlety, and then you pull out your big guns.
Thank you. Heard it all. The subtlety in the big guns, too. Pace Pace from Verdi's La Forza del Destino. Grace Bumbry, our guest today in the Great Artist Series, the conductor Aldo Ciccato. Of course, it is Nabucco that Grace Bumbry will be singing at the New York City Opera, opening night Thursday, and four subsequent performances, Sunday the 20th, that's a week from today, Wednesday the 23rd, Saturday the 26th, Tuesday the 29th. Grace, you gave us before some indication of pieces that you want to record, from Barry Manilow to Gioconda.
Mm-hmm.
What are you actually going to be singing this season after the Nabucco run here? What else can we...
Not here in New York. Immediately after I leave here, I go on a recital tour in Europe, Paris, Geneva, Zurich, Bonn, Cologne, Rome, I believe, is seven or eight concerts. And then I do a recording of recital music with Jeffrey Parsons. And then I come back in November. I go to Seattle to do three concerts there with Seattle Symphony of the Weisendonck Cycle, I believe it is. And then I go to Los Angeles for the Nabucco with City Opera. And that takes us up to beginning of December. And then I stop for a month and a half, because I have to start studying Medea. And so I'm taking that period off for study, and then I start some other concerts in America here in January, and including that wonderful concert we're going to have with Shirley Verrett, a duet evening.
Yes, we are trying to work out dates for the two of you to come on the listening room.
Oh, that'd
in the
be
morning.
Wonderful.
So as soon as we can juggle those around,
that would be wonderful.
Yes, we'll have a big splash.
Yeah, and then after that, I think I go back to Europe, if I'm not mistaken. And then there's
hard to keep
Don
track.
Carlos in Houston. Oh, it's busy season. But no, I come back in June for the Met, for Trovatore, for the June Park, the Met Park concerts. Uh-huh. Yeah. So I'm singing Leonore for the first time in the park.
Very good. You see, you're just full of debuts.
Yeah, sure.
Grace Bumbry, great delight to have you here. And we look forward to your return, which
Thank
will
you.
Be not too far away
too far
with
away.
Shirley Verrett.
Not too far.
So, thanks again.
Thank
and
you.
We do close out on that very cheerful and forward-looking note.